Are you ready? Ready? Ready?
Just notified me of Children's Church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we may dismiss right now for Children's Church.
Hey.
All right. You can say it right there, young man. You too big. Go ahead, sit down. You good enough? Are you good? All right. Huh? Oh, for the play. Okay. They just let me know stuff off the cuff. All right, they done clap their hands. Clap, clap, clap. Sing it. In Jesus' name, give all the teachers back there the anointing. Heavenly Father. Amen. Jaden by himself can handle 25 men. We would like to welcome you to Divine Truth Christian Center, where God wants your dreams and visions realized. We'd also welcome our guests and our family that is here, even our online guests that are watching us around the world this morning. So my brother Vince in the back said, Pastor Martin, do you realize that folk be walking across the camera? I was like, yes, because I want them to be compelled to come into the house of the Lord. Amen. So every time you walk across the camera and somebody was looking for you, just wave and just say, hey, this is where I am. Amen. That's your evidence right there. So I'd like to tell you to welcome you to Divine Truth Christian Center, where God wants your dreams and visions realized. I want to give honor to God, for without him, we would not be able to do anything. Also would like to give reverence to my wife, Lady Martin, First Lady of this house, my family, visitors, members, and online guests. I have a word for you today. If you would just look on the screen, you can either turn with me as well, or I should actually change that to update it to the 21st century. Open up your iPhone or your Android device and take your index finger as well as your opposable thumb and then stretch the screen and open up your Bible to Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Amen. Amen. Pages rustled back in the 90s, but since the phones came out, everybody got the stuff on their phone. Amen. Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. And it says this as follows. You can see it on your screen. And even those of you that are watching at home, you could also see it on your screen as well. It says in verse 17, though the fig tree may not blossom, nor the fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will praise and I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like deer's feet, and he will make me walk on my high hills. To the chief musician with my stringed instruments. The topic today, I'm praising my way through. I'm praising my way through just to be closer to you. Amen. Hallelujah. Be blessed, people of God.
I'm praising my way through just to be closer to you.
Amen. Trouble, issues, problems, circumstances, a whole lot of mess going on. But I'm going to praise my way through. Amen. So what is this unique term, praise, quote unquote? Well, praise means the Lord. Let me help you. Let's go ahead and give a round of applause for the Lord. Amen. It means to laud. Yeah, yeah. Okay, you get it. It also means to commend, compliment, or shower with adoration. Amen. This thing called praise, it actually feels good. It sounds good to the average ear and sounds even better to God in heaven. Praise is an exercise, not in futility. No, it's not that. But in celebration. Yeah. And it is the foreshadow or prelude when entering into courtship or free spiritual intimacy with God. Okay, you'll get it in just a moment. It happens before worship in many cases, which is therapeutic in nature. Worship actually in the Greek means therapeuo or therapeutic in nature, and is also described as a glorious presence. This particular sequence is all too familiar for those of us who love God and have come into his presence and worship him and praise him and get into his glory. The same sequence, praise and worship. You know where I'm going, Lady Martin. Praise and worship. Praise and worship is all too familiar when a loving husband and wife join together and consummate the marriage bed. You know how it is. I remember there was often times when my wife and I were just going to talk about us, not anybody else. When my wife and I would come back from a honeymoon or a trip or coming from out of town, or I would see some folk going from out of town and they had been stressed when they left, but when they come back, they look like they're glowing. Why do you glow when you come? Okay, y'all acting like you don't know what I'm talking about. Just watch my wife and I after we come back from a trip. You'll see what I'm talking about. Amen. And usually what ends up happening is what follows after you see a person glowing in the natural, first the natural, then the spirit, is follows reproduction. You go on the trip as two or to the mountains as two, but you come back with three or four or five or six or seven. You know what I'm talking about. You reproduce, first the natural, then the spirit. Praise, celebrating God. Worship, intimacy with God. Fruit is being bared in your life. That's what's produced. Likewise, on a husband and a wife, you celebrate your husband and you celebrate your wife. You compliment them. You say, baby, you look wonderful. You look like a bag of Snickers. You look wonderful. You celebrate them. And then after that, you worship. And then it's praise and worship. Praise and worship. Okay, that's my... Okay, stop, Pastor Martin. That's in our marriage class. You get me in just a moment. Reproduction follows, or fruit rather. This is what happens when you praise and worship God. This is what happens when you go beyond the veil, because Jesus, when he died on the cross, the veil was torn from top to bottom, and you now could go into his presence without having a priest there sitting in a box somewhere saying, hello, are you? Let me. What do you got to tell me today? No, you don't have to do that. You could go boldly before the throne of grace. And what happens when you get in the room behind the curtain? There's a movie that I love. My wife loves the Wizard of Oz. I love The Wiz. ease on down the road. Da, da, da. She likes the... She likes that. I like The Wiz. I want to see who is the man behind the mask. I want to see who's... Move with some stop, as he used to say in the Emeralds. I want to see what's behind that. I want to have fellowship with that individual. So if you understand that, it is the same way with God. I want to see what is behind the veil. Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us. And when we get into his presence, when we get into his glory, we begin to glow. And you, in other words, you begin to emit what is on you. You begin to reflect what is on you. For we are in the mirror image and likeness of God. We reflect what is being shown on us. And so when you get into the glory of God, you are glowing now. It looks like you are ready to reproduce. You're ripe to produce fruit. What kind of fruit are you talking about, Pastor Martin? Well, dreams, visions, and blessings are all being birthed in the Spirit. You may go in by yourself before God, but when you come out glowing, you'll discover that there's dreams and visions that will be realized, and you now have the ability to reproduce, to be fruitful and multiply. That is the actual mandate that God has for all of us, is that we should be fruitful and multiply, not just bury our talents and not just keep ourselves together and not just do just one good thing throughout your entire. No, there's so much that God has packed on the inside of us, and we don't even know that we have hidden treasures inside of this earthen vessels. And so when we get before the presence of God, he begins to unlock things on the inside of you, and you begin to reproduce. You go in as one, but you may come in and as four or five or ten. You have so many talents that you have yet to discover. But initially, you need to praise God. You need to court him just a little bit, just a little bit. It's no wonder that children at times are born in tough times. Amen. Okay, I'm going somewhere with this. Isn't it so funny that when you praise in God, God wants you to praise him when you're going through tough times and through tough situations. He wants you to be able to get through things. He wants you to be able to endure hardness as a good soldier. He wants you to produce even though there's a famine in the land. Because I assure you, God is never, never barren. He always wants you to just come into his presence so that you could produce something. Each time, every time. Children are born in tough times. You ain't got nothing else to do. Oh, Lord. And let the church say, amen. You ain't got nothing else to do. We might as well practice. Okay, let me keep on going. It is the antidote when you praise God to depression and despair. So when you're feeling down and out, or lost in need, or in need of a way to escape legally into the spiritual bliss of God's presence, pump up the volume, and put a praise on it. Pastor Martin, what are you talking about? I need some Bible right here. Okay, we'd like to hear it. Here it go. Isaiah chapter 61, verse 3 says, to console those who mourn in Zion or in his church, to give them beauty for ashes. This is what praise does for you. The oil of joy for mourning. The garment of praise. That means I got to put it on it. Put on something for the spirit of heaviness. That they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he, watch this, may be glorified. Who got the praises? And who gonna give them to? Jesus. Who got the praises? And who we gonna give them to? Jesus. That's a song right there. We're gonna give God the praises that he is due. So when you're down and moping and somebody gives you some bad news, one thing that makes the devil just go out of his mind is when you're ready to get down and start crying, you say, Lord, I praise you. Despite how I feel, despite the circumstances, despite what I'm going through, I'm praising my way through, just to get closer to you. Oftentimes, cohesion is made through adversity. When I was pledging, when I was in college, all of my line brothers used to be there, and they used to make us do all manner of sinful things. It was a very serious type of situation. They had us way out in the woods in Tallahassee somewhere. The cops came up. They had their guns drawn, and he said, we're practicing for boot camp. They were, oh, man, I can't even say it. But some of our best friendships were forged in adversity. And watch this, as soon as the trouble was over, or as soon as we came across the burning sands, we began to celebrate. saying that we've crossed, we've made it through this situation, and the bonds that have been formed. I got fraternity brothers even up to this day, 20 or 17 years later, that still say, Pastor Bart, you saved now, but I remember when. And I said, I remember when too. Those were some great times. So let me keep on going. It is the antidote when you praise God to depression and despair. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 21 says this. He says, okay, well, he is your praise. Who is the praise? He is your praise. Who's God? He is your God who has done for you these great and awesome things which your eyes have even seen. God will let you see some things that'll make you pat your hands together, that'll make you stand on your feet, that'll make you just yell out, say, Lord God, I celebrate you in this moment. I went through a lot. I've cried my tears. I have pressure on my back. There's different type of circumstances. There's different type of situations. The dog is crying. The cat is running around scratching me in my head, and I don't have no food for it. But yet and still, I will still praise you, Lord. I don't have no places to stay. I don't have no job. I don't even have nobody to hug me in the middle of the night. But yet, God, I will still praise you. I got more bills than I got more money. I got more bills than I have money. I'm preaching, y'all. I got more bills than I have money. But nevertheless, I will still praise you. Okay, you just don't get it just yet. So I guess I'm just going to have to teach on this just for a few more minutes. Second Chronicles chapter 5, verses 13 through 14 will give you a nice little stage that needs to be set. Because you can look at me like you don't even know what's going on, or that you have your tradition of where you come from. You just have to stand still like some religious tradition where you're just supposed to stand still and just be like, oh my goodness, I don't know what he's going to do next. He's really louder this weekend than he was last weekend. What had happened to it? No. What I am letting you know is that you need to celebrate God. Oh, who wants to serve a God? And you call yourself a child of God, and everybody is like, nobody knows the trouble I see. Nobody knows my sorrow, going into the church door. No. I want you to know about the God that I serve. I'm giving him a plug right now. The author and the finisher of our faith, the great I am, the everlasting Father, the Rose of Sharon. He is the great I am. He is the great I am. I am what? I am what God is saying. Anything or everything that you could ever need, everything that you could ever need in your life, he is the one who could give you what you need when no one else can. Well, let's Second Chronicles. I'm getting ahead of myself. Chapter 5, verses 13 through 14 tells us a little bit of how David and the boys could set the stage. It says, indeed, it came to pass when the trumpeters and singers were as one. We are one. Ba, 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 ba. Okay, y'all don't know what I'm talking about. That's Who is that? Okay, you don't know. All right, let me keep on going. We are one. Indeed, it came to pass. Frankie Beverly and Maze, for all y'all know. No, you need to go back in your iPod. When the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. And when they lifted up their voices with the trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For his mercy endures forever. That the house, who house? God's house. Whose house? Say what? God's house. Say what? God's house, the house of the Lord, was filled with a cloud, so that the priest could not continue ministering because of the cloud. For the glory of the Lord filled in that house. God was on the scene. Isaiah said, I saw him, and he was high and lifted up, and his train or his glory filled the temple. And then not only filled the temple that was around Isaiah, but it also filled him too. Man can see God unless he is filled and has holiness within him. Whose house? God's house. Now this whole thing begins to make a little bit of sense right here. Because these boys, or these instruments, or these folk that were with David, they were actually in the place of consecration. You do realize, if you didn't get the memo or the notes, or you don't look at Facebook only but once a month, we are in a 21-day consecration. So that we could set ourselves apart before God, because we are expecting God in 2013, number three, that is our third year, the year of completion, for God to do some great and marvelous things. And if you are willing to go with me, and if you're willing to see what I see, do you see what I see? Then God has some great things for us. They were in a place of consecration, standing in earnest expectation with a praise outside, no, in their mouths for the ark, or the order of God was with them. David and the boys begin to praise and worship God. They begin to lift him up, all because they had the Ark of the Covenant, which once was lost, but then was found. Isn't it so funny that when you have lost something and you have found that, I'm looking for my keys, I'm trying to get to work this morning, I'm trying to find the tickets to the Universal, and I don't want to go back to college. No. And you find them inside of your pocket, and you like, wow, I've got them. I found it, and you begin to be relieved. This is the same way that David and the boys felt when the order of God, the ark of God, was found, for it was stolen. It was taken away. Don't let the glory of God be taken away from your house. For if the glory of God is taken away from your house, then you have no power. You can pray all you want to. You can put all your posts on Facebook about how much you love the Lord and he heard my cry, and all of the scriptures by line, upon precept. But if you do not abide the Lord God in your house and his glory is not there, then you have no power. Have no power. They had a Holy Ghost party. They had a Holy Ghost party. The battery was like, and the church said, amen. And the man. They had a Holy Ghost party, y'all. I could even hear Kirk Franklin saying right now, we want a Holy Ghost party, because the Holy Ghost party don't stop. It don't stop. They were partying right then. They were celebrating God. And watch this. The preacher didn't have to say nothing, because he was standing there before God as well. They were praising them all together as one. Whenever you see a cloud, it means actually a few things. Number one, shade. It also can mean that a storm is to come. I see a storm a brewing, as the old people would say, or just rain. And the latter rain, this will help somebody, you could have shout right there, will be greater than the former rain. Rain actually means blessings, abundance, no lack, robust health, energized, I'm heating up, or an expression of amplified glory. In other words, when you praise God, you experience glory, and it's a game changer. Michael Jordan is sitting on the bench and all the time is running out, just like Jordan in 94. He's sitting on the bench, sick in his body. They can't even get the points where they need to do. And all of a sudden, he gets his strength again and he gets him in the game. I can see the faces of the people that are on the other team. I was like, oh, suck it. Now I need to put some defense on. This is just like the enemy. When they see you coming to the house, then all of a sudden the game begins to change. Not necessarily because you have the power, because you're working with the sixth man. Who is the sixth man? We're talking about Christ here. We're talking about the fourth man. It's like a theophany. When you see the Hebrew boys that were inside of the fire, they were sitting there. They were believing God. They were going through the fire. It's hot. It's hot, baby. They were sitting there in the heat. And then all of a sudden, the fourth man began to appear. It was a game changer. Though you may be in the fire right now, you shall not be consumed. You won't be consumed, not at all. Psalms chapter 104, verses 1 through 2, begins to tell us this in a little bit better. It says, bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. If I'm serving a great and marvelous and big God with big house with lots and lots of room, if I'm serving a big God, then why do I talk so little about him? Why do I serve him in such a little way? Why don't I commit myself? I commit myself to everything else. I commit myself to my family, my kids, my job. But why do I commit myself to the one that could change my circumstances at the drop of a dime? You've been doing it all your way in year one, year two, year three, year four, year five. It's keep on going by. Keeps on going by. You need a game changer. You need the sixth man to go ahead and get up out of heaven and come and be there on your behalf. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh Lord, my God, and you are very great. You are clothed with honor and majesty. He's clothed with honor and majesty. Just as you see the sun, how it's bright and how it's radiant and how it's shining and how you feel so great when you go outside, just as well as God is clothed in majesty, who cover yourself, as the verse goes on to say, with light as with a garment. He puts on the sun. His nightlights are all of the stars. The dust from his feet are like the clouds that you see day by day. The earth is this footstool. There's a ladder going up to heaven, and we see angels ascending and descending. He has all of the host of heaven just at his beckoning call. He could take the blinded eyes that were once closed to all spiritual things and physical things, that he could open them up right before your eyes. He can make the lame walk. He can make the dumb to speak. God can change some things, but you got to praise him first. You got to court him first. You got to come into his presence first. You can't come in there all sad and all lonely and all beat down like nothing is happening. You need to praise God. Just as you like compliments. Look, brother, you look nice. You look fresh. You're fresh to death. You're with your ballet socks on, ballet shoes on. You look fresh and makes you feel good. It puts hair on your chest, even if you got none. It doesn't matter. God wants to hear the praises of his people. Who will cover yourself with light as with a garment? Who stretches out the heavens like a curtain? That just makes a lot of sense. Oh, she's headed to help me. Amen. Amen. Who stretches out the heavens like a curtain? All I know is that oftentimes when you see a curtain, it means that you're hiding something. So I think most of us need to take off the mask with this religious type of talk and religious type of thinking. Heaven is, isn't it the most mind-boggling thing when somebody knows a whole lot of scriptures, a whole lot of word, but don't do what they know? Sounds like there's a disconnect. There's a disconnect right here. You need to get into the presence of God so not only you can hear and speak, but you can also do. It is so easy to be like everybody else. Everybody is seeking after the flesh. Everybody is after the physical things, but you can scratch the itch of the physical part, but the physical part will change. Just ask gravity. Just ask everybody in here who is once 20, then 30, then 40, then 50. It begins to change. So that means you need to rely on something besides your flesh. I need to praise God, because when you praise God, it begins to crucify your flesh. You have been conditioned to be inside of church like this. Preacher preaching his guts out. Just like that frog. Remember that frog from Looney Tunes? Brat. Brat. And then, as soon as everybody leaves, hello, my darling. Hello, my baby. Hello, my granny pal. You only got my heart on fire. God wants you to do all of that when he's looking and when everybody else is looking too. You can't be ashamed of him, for we are not ashamed of the gospel. No. And the thing about this light thing, God said in the very beginning, and then there was light, or and then there was glory. In other words, when you praise God, it's like photosynthesis. I'm going to do a little rapping right here. We never been where we at. I'm going to put my shoulders on. I'm going to go ahead and see. When you praise God, it's like photosynthesis. Your situation breaks through the heavens, reaches to the ears of God, and gets his emphasis. You like that? I like that. I put the little bar right there. It's like two or three bars. When you praise God, it's like photosynthesis. It breaks through all type of fallow ground, and then he gives what you have to say emphasis. Ladies, isn't it so funny? I'm talking about, if you've been married and you have a brute of a husband like me, and you just trying to, you know what I'm saying, be a little friendly with your hugs. Amen. You can't just go up in there and talk about something. Come here, woman. Like a barbarian to put her over the shoulder. She'd be like, I can't get there. I can't do that. No way. It ain't going to happen. I'm sorry. Doors closed. No. It's not going to happen. But if I look at it, I say, look at you. Need a coffee in my crib. Look at that. She's smiling. She can't even help. Yeah. If you understand. And that's the same way, God, when you compliment God, it makes him feel good. Ladies, if you have a husband there and you want him to take out the garbage, take out the garbage, take out the trash, go over here, turn right, turn left, go to the store, don't say nothing, be quiet. And you having him do it over and over again, why don't you give him a compliment just one time, just one time. Just one time, baby. You look at your beard. It's manly. It's manly. I understand your drawers are on the floor. It doesn't matter. I still love you anyway. Look at you. Oh, baby, you just make me feel good. You hold me tight at night. Man, I tell you right now, that man will run through walls. He'll build the whole house. He'll build the whole house for you. All because you gave him a compliment. You gave him some praise. How much more will God do for you when you compliment and you praise him and you put your hands together for him and you celebrate him and you tell him how much you love him? God, I believe, sometimes gets tired of just hearing your problems. Only time you talk to him is when you're going through. How about you praise your way through? Amen. For God is even good to the unthankful and evil. So why not you celebrate him just for who he is? The funny thing about photosynthesis is that it's a phenomenon. Okay, let me help you a little bit. Some of us missed that class in science. Okay, the more you stretch upward, as it relates to trees, because God sees us as trees, the more you stretch upward, the more sun you get. Okay, I don't think you get that. When you have a tree, the way that the trees are able to get all of their branches and able to give off so much is because they begin to stretch up towards the sun. Likewise, being that we are spiritual beings and we're talking about first the natural, then the spirit, the more that you stretch up, the more God you will actually be able to get. And I'm talking about the S-O-N. The more sun you get, the more oxygen a tree produces. And since we are like trees, and since we have breath, that lets me know that everything that have breath needs to praise the Lord. When I stretch up to heaven and I begin to praise and worship God, I'm giving off and I'm producing the breath. I'm giving God praises. I'm producing something versus always asking him something. This society that we're in is a very consumeristic society. I was preaching about this just the other night, where we're looking for a church that has this particular size, this type of preacher. The preacher needs to be this high, this type of shade, wears glasses, doesn't need to wear shoes, needs to wear socks. All these different types of things. Because we're looking for something that will suit us, like we're going inside of Walmart. But the Bible says that you should be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and that you should come into subjection up under the auspices of God, and that you should be the one that should follow and submit your will and your way to God, not you trying to get God to submit and fit into your parameters. How are you going to fit God into what you got going on? And he's bigger than whatever you could even ask or think. Insanity is defined as doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. If you're looking for something to change, don't look outward, look inward. And look what God has to say regarding the matter. You produce something when you stretch up. You produce something. Produce. I have a young lady in here that knows about a produce section inside a grocery store. And if you think about produce, it begins to put something in the mind. Here's a question for you. I'd like to hear it. Here it go. What is sweet, has fullness of colors inside of the produce section? Watermelon. Fruit. That is in the produce section. Okay, somebody, I would have ran through this wall and knocked down all this drywall if you would have got the revelation just right there. If you in the produce section, you normally see fruit. You produce fruit. You produce fruit. I'm going to say it again. You produce fruit. You produce fruit. When you are in the presence of God, you produce fruit. You produce fruit. Apples, watermelon, put the lime and the coconut. Produce fruit. In the produce section, you always see fruit. You always see something that is beneficial. So therefore, what is the fruit? The fruit is gifts, talents, abilities. You serving other folk. You loving one another. You having the gifts of the Spirit. That you have all these things that you want to do for other people versus you trying to get something from someone else. Producing fruit. Proverbs chapter 18 verse 20 says this so delicately. It says, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. Because I believe I lost a couple of y'all with the whole photosynthesis thing. I told you that class. You might want to take it over again. Like to hear it. Here it go. Photosynthesis is the way that a tree begins to react when it is in the presence of the sun. And as a result of it being in the presence of the sun, it begins to give off oxygen. And being that we are a symbol and type of a tree, as trees or as people, when we begin to get into the presence of the S-O-N, when Jesus comes into our lives, he wants us also to begin to produce fruit. Where is the fruit, Pastor Martin? Well, if you look at this verse right here, it says, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips, he shall be filled. It goes on in the latter part of that verse. It says that life and death is in the power of the tongue. So if you got a nasty, rotten mouth, you should bet your bottom down to believe that you're going to have nasty things going on and swirling on around you. Mouth is a terrible thing. This little thing, this tongue, is the strongest muscle inside of the entire human body. It casts spells. You're never going to be amount to anything. It sticks with you for years. You can speak life. You know you're going to be great. I believe in you. And that sticks with you for years. That's why even if somebody may have said some terrible things about you and they're running off at the mouth and they're cussing and fussing and all this other stuff that they done imitated from the world or some trifling rap song, when they read the word of God and you speak the word of God in their lives, it begins to give life and life more abundantly. Producing fruit from your lips. Okay, I think somebody's getting it. Psalms chapter 23, verses 1 through 6 begins to give us an illustration about how we should praise our way through. Okay, I need some participation. Josh, come on up here. Ryan, come on up here. Jonathan, come on up here. Amen. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand in front of the pulpit. You're on camera now. Just tie yourself up. It's all right. It's all right. So I'm praising my way through just to get closer to God. Now, both of y'all face towards me. Everybody get in a group that way. Over there by Jonathan. Back up. Go over there. Go over there. There it is. There it is. There it is. There it is. Distractions. Depression. Fear. I'm in a situation right now. And I got, watch this. Go ahead and put your hand against my hand like you're pushing. And push behind him. And push behind him. Oh, Lord, I'm getting weak right here. And see, watch this. What am I doing? I'm doing something up under my own flesh. I got all this stuff coming against me. I got all these circumstances going against me. I'm trying to do it. I'm looking at Facebook. I'm looking for an inspirational post, something that's going to help me. And I can barely do it. I can't. I'm in a situation. The pressure hasn't stopped yet. It's Monday, y'all, after the preacher has stopped preaching. And I still got all this stuff. I barely even see my destiny ahead of myself because I got so much stuff coming against me. But the wonderful thing about God is that if you learn the science, if you learn the anointing of how you can praise away, you can just praise. I praise God against my circumstances. I praise God no matter what I got going on. All these things don't move me. They got to get out of my way. They got to get out of my way. I got to move all those things up out of here, up out of here. I got to breathe into my situation. I gotta bring him into my circumstances. No matter what I got on in my life, I gotta follow God. And besides him, there is none other. You may have a lot of stuff that is coming against you and you trying to handle it with your flesh. Maybe if I cuss him out about 15 times, they'll get up off of me. They'll get up off of me. Man, please. There is nothing good in the flesh. And the flesh can never be satisfied.
it enjoys evil things. It never changes because of bad stuff. That's what it gravitates to. But when you evolve the spirit inside of the things that's going on in your life, and you got all this stuff, it feels like the weight of the world is on your shoulder. You feel like you're Atlas, and you got the earth on your shoulders. But God is teaching you how to praise your way through, and you got to get all that stuff out of your mind, out of your heart. It may still be going on. But what you're doing is that you're not celebrating in a situation. You are in a situation, not the situation. You need to write that down. You're not the situation. You are in it. You're in something. And what we need to do is that when we have the storms of life swirling around us and we got all this debris and all these distractions and all this despair and all this depression and all this anxiety and all this fear and all this doubt and all this unbelief swirling around us over and over and over again, we have to be careful that we keep our eyes on God. The eye of the storm is clear. So therefore, we need to keep our eyes on God so that we, although we have the storm swirling around us, that we don't get the storm on the inside of us and we become what we're going through. Make sure that you don't become what you're going through. My sons, when I talk about this nice little cartoon backyard again, if you're a parent, you know about all these cartoons. And I like watching them too, quite frankly. And I look at the Backyardigans, and my favorite character of all the Backyardigans, you can guess which one it is, the penguin. The penguin is my favorite one because he got this fresh thing. He got his hat on and all this other stuff. He know how to be dancing. He be just moving around, all this other stuff. And one of these times, he came to this forest. It was a swamp. They had this beautiful mansion. They saw this forest. It's dark and all this other stuff. But watch this. The penguin got up in front. And I said, let's go ahead and find the golden boot. And they begin to go inside of the forest, and they have all of, the penguin had all of the other characters trailing him, and then they begin to sing a song, into the thick of it, into the thick of it, and we don't know where we're going, into the thick of it, and they're singing, they were not moved by what they saw in front of them, they were not moved by all of the darkness and calamity that was around them, they were not moved by the things or the impending doom that was right there at their footstep, they were saying, into the thick of it, into the thick of it, and we don't know where we're going, into the thick of it, we were going through the thick of it, and they were singing the entire way. This brings to mind Psalms chapter 23. They, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for my rod and the staff are with me. I see God right in front of me. I'm in the thick of it, y'all, and I don't know where I'm going. But I believe that that is a revelation right there, because we are in the darkness of the night of our situation, and it seems like we can't see nothing. We can't see our way out of this thing. It seems like there are no doors that I can even go through. Not door number one, not door number two, not door number three. They got padlocks on all of those things. But I'm reminded that the Bible says that God says that he will open up a door that no man can shut. And when since he can open up a door that no man can shut, I can boldly walk through that thing. And I could go into the thick of it because I got God with me. He is with me. He will never leave me or forsake me. So God told me to tell you that you have to walk it out. You know that song, walk it out, walk it out, walk it out. You got to walk it out. You got to walk out this thing. You got to keep on moving. I don't know what the most brilliant man knows. I don't have it all together. But if anybody will tell you, whether it's from the neighborhood all the way even to Orlando, if there's anything you can say about Pastor Martin, is that I'm consistent. I'm a stubborn old hound. I'm going to keep on going. It doesn't matter. I'll be here by myself. I'm going to praise God by myself. I'll pray by myself. I'm going to keep on going because I know what God has placed before me. I can't be moved. These things. Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself. Hold my mule. So we're walking it out. And if those cartoons can get the revelation into the thick of it, and we don't know where we're going. And that is exactly how God wants it to be. He wants you to keep on walking, even though you don't know where you're going. Well, what do you mean by that, Pastor Martin? That does not seem logical to me. Well, it makes a lot of sense. Why? Because the Bible says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. I need to step out on nothing so I could get to something. I need to step out on the things that God has for me. I got stepping stones of success. Even though the devil may have tried to put a stumbling block before me and I didn't even know where I was going, I done fell, I done got backslidden, I done had some things happen to my life. Those things that were once coming against me can now be the stepping stones to my success in God. But I gotta praise him through. I gotta praise him through. Psalms chapter 40, verses 1 through 3 says, to the chief musician, a psalm of David, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and he heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. Order my steps to your word. Order my steps to your word. He ordered my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth. Praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. What will they see? What will they fear? My praise. Oh my goodness. When they see me praising, I'm here as a single mother and I should be here or broken down and always begging, but yet I'm still praising God and I'm celebrating God and I have my head up and I keep on moving and I keep on going forward. I am godly. I am a woman of God. I can take care of all this thing. I can meet my Boaz and I can get with of all of these other types of, okay, let me keep on going. I'm going to keep on going. I'm going to keep on moving because I know of whom I believe. I know why I believe. And I'm not going to be moved by everything that's going on in this world. I'm tired of doing it like everyone else. And you should be too. God is teaching you how to praise in the waiting room. The scripture said that we waited patiently for the Lord. Because some of us have gotten into this ATM mentality. But how are you going to make a withdrawal if you never deposit anything? How are you going to make a withdrawal from God when you don't give anything? Because he's just God, and besides him, there is none other? No, no, no. If you've been saved, and some of us do need to be saved, by the way. I won't even get into that. But I've been coming to church a long time. Nah, you're not saved just yet because your conduct, okay. Pastor Martin, okay. You need to be able to understand how to praise God while you're waiting. Waiting. Lord, when the people going to come? When the business going to pop off? When is it going to happen, Lord? I preached a message a little while ago. Lord, when is it going to happen? When is it going to pop off? God, you placed all this stuff inside of me. That's one of the things that if you are an extremely talented and gifted person and God has packed all this anointing in the inside of you, it is extremely frustrating to know what is on the inside of you and you ain't there yet. It's frustrating. It's like you're in jail. It's like you're restricted. And but God, just like I was telling a young man today, God sometimes has us in a dark place. And he hides us. Because when God sees us, he doesn't see people. He sees seeds. Sometimes a seed needs to be in a dark place first. Under pressure. No one sees you. You got this big giant redwood tree on the inside of the small seed. But no one sees the tree yet. They just see all the trees around and everybody's fascinated by all of the stuff and all of the things that people got going on in their lives and they've already bloomed, but you're still yet up under the ground. But the funny thing about God is that when it comes to a seed, the bigger the tree is, the deeper the roots have to go. So you have to go down deep before you can go up and celebrate as you're going down. Because the funny thing about the revelation about roots is that as it begins to go down and deep into the ground, the thing that it is seeking after is what? Water. You don't get water up there first. You get water going down deep. You need to go into the thick of it. You need to go through some things. You got to go up under a certain amount of pressure so that you can handle when the storms blow. Because the deeper the roots are, when the storms of life come and your tree is out there in the wind, inside of the sun, inside of the rain, through storms, through clouds, through the summer, the spring, the winter, and the fall, you can still stand there. Storms blowing. You still have the ability All of the other trees are falling because they're hollow on the inside, shallow on the inside. But yet your deep roots are there, fortified, and you're after the water. And they shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of living water, and you shall bear much fruit in your due season. And it may not be your season yet. You need to get that message delayed, but not denied. A delay is not a denial. God sometimes wants to pressure you and put an intense amount of pressure on you, not to hurt you, not to break you, but to bless you. Diamonds are formed up under intense amount of pressure, because the diamond, the revelation about the diamond is that he wants you to be beautiful and hard too. That means you could take some things. That means you could go through some things. No metal can scratch you. The only thing that can hurt you is another diamond. You can do some things. And you're beautiful at it too. In other words, you'll be displayed for all the world to see, and they will see your value. But no one sees the value of being in the dirt. You have to be in the dirt first. He's teaching us how to praise in the waiting room. You are about to be examined as you're waiting. I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm waiting on. You're waiting in the waiting room. Who are we waiting on, Pastor Mark? We're waiting on the great physician. And I assure you that he has a remedy for what is afflicting you. So come high or drinking hell water. Somebody will get that in a minute. You can praise your way through it. Eyes red, coming into the sanctuary. You done drunk that green tea? You know, you know, got that taste off of your breath. You know, had your peppermints, and you still coming to church. But that's exactly how God wants you to be, because he wants you to see him right when you in the middle of your mess, so that you will find out and realize that it was him who brought you out of it. You can praise your way through it. Distractions, depression, all these things sometimes are illusion. The enemy tries to peek and put all these things into our head over and over again. You ain't going to make it. You ain't going to go nowhere. You ain't the smartest in your class. You ain't got no scholarship. You got all this stuff going on. You don't have nothing. You ain't going nowhere. Look at you. Look at you. You're ugly. Your legs look like baseball bats. All this other type of stuff the enemy tries to put inside of your ear. But in the midst of hearing all of that, I'm still going to praise you, Lord. Praise you. Going through all this stuff, swirling around you and in you. Some of us feel like there's an organized attack of chaos in our minds. That's why I'm not fooled by your stone faces. Faces don't move me. You kidding me? You don't know what I've been through? I've been preaching to the teddy bear and my two kids for 2 years before I saw any of y'all. So trust me, I know what a stone face and giggling and distraction know all about. But I'm going to preach anyway. I got to see this thing. You got to see this as well. You got all this organized chaos in your mind. Can't even get into the word of God. Everybody's praising and on their feet and you standing there. I don't know what this is all about. I got to observe this church about 3 more years first. Let's see if they're really real. Are you kidding me? God is not changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So no matter where you go, you need to celebrate him despite of. Paul gives us a good example of how he made the devil oh so mad when he was going through the intense calamity for the sake of the gospel. And even if you're going through all of this stuff and all this pressure, people ain't believing you. They're not supporting you. They're not supporting your dream. They're not into your thing that you got going on. You may have all this stuff going on and you ain't got nothing to sit on. You ain't got a pot nor a window. You feel in the blame. But I see what the Bible says in Acts chapter 20, verse 24. This will make you run around the building. And when we get our bigger building, I'm going to make you run then. It says, but none of these things move me. None of these things move me. Nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I might, watch this, might finish my race with joy. And the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. None of these things move me. I'm not a mixed martial artist fighter. I'm just consistent. So you may get me today, and my brother tell you, but you got to come through the neighborhood tomorrow. You got to come through my street tomorrow. I may have a black eye today. My arm may be broken, but it's eventually going to heal. And I'm the type of person that if you don't beat me the first day, I'm going to hit you the next day, and I'm going to keep on hitting you. And after a while, you're just going to be like, man, I don't feel like fighting no more. Okay, if you need to come to the neighborhood one time, I don't feel like fighting no more. You just don't give up. You wrestling. What you finna do? What you finna do? What you finna do? What you finna? No. I'm finna hit you right now. I'm gonna split you to the white meat. Why? Because I'm gonna keep on fighting. I'm gonna keep on being consistent. The devil always tries to give you a knockout blow and see he's not gonna get up this time, just like Manny Pacquiao last night. But he should have kept. Okay, let me keep up. You may be knocked out. And the devil is always going to try to hit you with a real hard punch to see if you ain't going to get up. You're going to curl up into the fetal position. Oh, I got you now. But if you could just keep on getting up, keep on getting up. I told you before with this illustration before about how I love wrestling. As fake as it is, I still like it. And how, I'm going to go back to the day. Jimmy Superfly Snooker. Was there on the ground, and I don't know who else it was. Maybe it was the elbow guy. I don't forgot what his name was. He's there on the ground. Dusty Rhodes. And Jimmy Snookify Snooker came off of the rope, and he did a turn off the turnbuckle, landed on his back, and he's out for the count. Dusty Rhodes is now laying on him and has his leg up in the air. 1, 2, 3. He raises his hand up. Not out for the count yet. 1, 2, 3. He raises his hand up again. Not out for the count. I even like it when Hulk Hogan does it. He's down on the ground. He's pressing his on him. The Undertaker's putting all his weight on him, just like the enemy. The enemy's trying to take you under, and he has all his pressure up under you. And the referee has you down. 1, 2, 3. He raises up his hand, and watch this. This is the thing that gets the whole crowd excited. He begins to shake his hand. He begins to wave that hand. He begins to move that thing around, and then he begins to move that leg. And then all of a sudden, he lifts him up off of it, and then he doo, 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 doo. And then he begins to throw him. Oh my God. And watch this. He said, he begins to show himself. Why? Because he seems like he was out. He seems like he was out for the count. But nevertheless, soon as he began to raise his hand, it's like we should raise our hand and begin to praise God. And don't let anybody keep your praise down. It doesn't matter how they look at you. They may look at you sideways. That ain't how we used to do it at our old church. But nevertheless, I'm praising God and not you. Not you. Not you. Because he's been so good to me. He was there when no one else was there. He was there who wiped my tears. He was there when some people were not trying to be in my vision. And you should feel the same way too. These things can't move me. Last but not least, I got a wonderful revelation right here. We're going to go ahead and get out of here. You can't be moved when you have a praise in your mouth. You have to be consistent in your love for God and express it. I remember Beyonce and them. Back in the day, used to say my name, when no one else is around you, tell everybody they love you. I done butchered them words, haven't I? I don't know. But the key of the song is that she was singing, basically saying, you need to let everybody know that you with me. Why are you going to tell me that I'm your girl and no one else? You ain't introduced me to the family. Nobody know who you are. You ain't exchanged no telephone numbers. You just a booty call. Okay, let me keep. Did you say booty in church? Well, booty is in the Bible. Okay, let me keep on going. I just want to get all that religion up out of you. You have to profess your love for God openly. I want everybody to know that I love him, and he has done a lot for me. He's not my private dancer, a dancer for money. Do it. No. I want God to be in there in front of me. I want to see him. I want to lift his name up because he's been so good. If God has done anything, thing for you if he has answered at least one or two prayers out of your life when you couldn't ask nobody else. I'm going to praise God. I'm going to worship him. I'm going to lift up his holy name. I'm going to say, you're the everlasting Father. You're the rose of Sharon. You're the great I am. You're the lily in the valley. And you also own all of the valleys with all of the lilies in it. I'm going to trust and praise God. Yes. Trust him and praise him. Hannah. My mom used to always tell me this story all the time about Hannah so earnestly wanted a child. Her womb was closed. And the scripture said that God was the one who actually did it. If you look at 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1 through 2, and it says, and Hannah prayed. Excuse me. In Samuel chapter 1, verse 12 through 15, and it says, and it happened as she continued praying before the Lord, because she was being teased because her